and worldviews, but really including psychological, empirical studies that
are related. The transdisciplinarity, which you're talking about.
Exactly. To make it much broader and more encompassing, and then using psychology educated academics to help compile some of those and to criticize some of the literature, so that you don't have a situation where people are simply inserting a few psychological citations for decoration, more than as
any
a driving motivator that is from the bottom up leading to a direction. So I think there's been a transition over time towards that model. But the most exciting model that I can cite from my experience recently in Australia comes from not just law reform commissions, but bodies charged with proposing recommendations for reform that are actually outside of our law reform agencies themselves, such as special commissions and particularly royal commissions of inquiry. Mm-hmm. So we've had two in Australia very recently, one on domestic violence, which was based in Victoria, and one that has been nationwide in its concerns as well, based in Sydney, the Royal Commission into Institutional Responses to Child Sexual Abuse. And that commission was initiated by Julia Gillard in about 2013, and is just concluding its activities this year after getting a bit of an extension. Mm-hmm. And I think what is remarkable is that they adopted an essentially evidence-based approach to all recommendations. Mm-hmm. And so they engaged with researchers across the country and actually soon depleted the pool of researchers who could do the kinds of projects that they envisaged in Australia and had to go oversized to fulfill the complement. But they sponsored over 100 studies, which is an extraordinary body of research related to a single topic. So there are many kinds of methodologies, some more qualitative and others more quantitative, depending on the issues and the researcher's skills. And then the commission has allowed, comments and rebuttal from members of the legal community, so that they too have been really engaging with the evidence that has been marshalled. And that's been quite a productive discussion. And sometimes there have been opportunities for the researchers to provide some repartee and additional responses to clarify aspects of their methodology and so on. And now the recommendations in their final form are, have been drafted and fielded and are about to come out. So it's been, I think, one of the most, far-ranging and extraordinary efforts to shift the way that reforms are recommended. And as a consequence, and because of the kind of process that has been set up, and the input from so many academics as well as legal practitioners, I think, and members of the public as well who've participated in hearings, I think it's going to give the final recommendations a great deal more weight and make it a much more solid body of recommendations, because they're so founded on evidence that I think it makes the potential for those to have an impact in terms of the reforms that are contemplated to really change the nature of the way these cases have been run. So that's the most exciting example that I can cite.
So I'm having two thoughts in response to the information that you've given me of the various models and the one which you think is the possibly the most exciting and productive. Considering we do not have this kind of initiative in the country at present, and in effect the school would be virtually advocating for it to be adopted. So I have two thoughts, and I thought it would be worthwhile to get your response to you could say my future plan of action, if one wants to put it like that, or at least the mini initiatives that we can start with One thought which I had was, if we as a law school did a status paper for our own law commission on other law commissions and how they have used empirical-based legal studies to feed law reform. You know, just a comparative paper, just as information, and then to sort of encourage or excite the law commission to take a similar route. You know, not say anything to them, but to say it is happening world over, and maybe we could also benefit from it. That was one thought which came. The other which was to look at the existing mandate of the law commission and see if we could do a literature-based kind of a survey for them. And actually, you know, like do the two things. Do one status paper, try to see if we can have a discussion around it. And the other was to in fact do it and give it to them and say, this is what we mean by empirical-based legal studies. What would your reaction to be? I mean, I'm not saying it just happened, but if it looks like it is something worth trying, then one can, you know, discuss it with students, other people, and say, why not? It may be a better way to engage with the commission, rather than to just go, you know, haranguing them on that this is what they should be doing. If we provided one service and one suggestion.
I think those are wonderful concrete approaches, mm-hmm. and I don't think it's really appropriate for me to sort of choose between them. I think they both would have persuasive value in different ways. You know, I think the comparative approach is really interesting because it's always educational to institutions to see how others akin to them function, mm-hmm. You know, and I would imagine that one of the things to highlight in making those comparisons is really the availability of funds and resources to sponsor research. Mm-hmm. So when our law reform commissions have done that, they've been fortunate to have had funding available, but not necessarily at the scale that our Royal Commission had, mm-hmm. you know, and so some mechanism, you know, might be needed if they're going to seriously undertake that process, not only to be able to fund the researchers who might apply to do that work, mm-hmm. But they've also got to be capable of evaluating it. When they get it, you know, yes. So those sorts of things might require, some illustrations of what sort of changes might be needed to make that more viable.
Okay, so just as a last follow-up question on this particular issue that we are discussing, see, this global initiative of academic networks primarily came as a way of making India one a preferred destination for academics, and at the same time to also benefit from the sort of knowledge work which is happening in other parts of the world. And considering everybody cannot be going, so to you invite people in. That is basically the prompting factor. So if we were to take the next logical thing and saying that because we had this initiative, we had a scholar who's come and kind of given us a certain level of insight on how a lot more informed law reform can happen. What should we be asking for our law commissions for this kind of evidence-based law reform to take off? You know, in terms of resources, in terms of institutional positions, like just the fact of that, all right, you might have a plethora of research being shown to you, but as you yourself have alerted us on a constant basis, that every research doesn't deserve to be given a similar kind of weightage and importance. And you need to discriminate and discern between that. You know, that discernment is a very important part of judging which research you should rely upon and which research is not worth that kind of trust. So if you could provide some level of that, okay, these may be things that you should ask for. See, we are basically going to be flying kites, but even if we are flying kites, we should fly the right kind of kites. I thought that
Sure. Some of them, you know, I mean, I think having participants from different disciplines would be one key, because a lot of the indications from empirical legal studies are that, you know, you need to have collaborative work produced by not just lawyers alone, but people who have other insights and other skills. And so that should happen at the law reform agency level as well.
So kind of a multidisciplinary body or a transdisciplinary body, which is like the advisory body for or the assisting body for the commission?
Yes, yeah, so but as well as individuals who are actually going to be
sitting on
evaluating and engaging. And so, so for example, in Sydney, with students that I was supervising doing research primarily in psychology with a legal application, I was able to arrange for regular placements of some of those students at the Law Reform Commission. Mm-hmm. And that, they usually just took law students. Mm-hmm. But because of my interest in fostering that sort of interdisciplinary approach, they found it actually very valuable. And that was the key that allowed them to start doing some of the data collection, mm-hmm. some of the data research, because those students were trained to be able to go out and do that. And so one of the first projects that happened was one on alternate